I said, as a chairman of the session, I have a very limited role, particularly in the context of the topic which we have today with respect to stressed assets and vis-a-vis the court proceedings. The matter being sub judice in Supreme Court, which is coming up probably the next week or next week. However, as the chairman and also a person who has been connected with the sector, who was connected with the sector from 1985-86 onwards, from the nascent stages of the development of the power plants, and also having been associated with the various power producers in the state, initially with the consumers and thereafter with the power producers in the state and across the country, I'll share my few of my thoughts with respect to these aspects. And the first, I would see, you all know that as per the, there's a report of the on power sector. I have gathered certain statistics from Central Electricity Authorities. The as on date, this is as on 31st October 2018. The installed capacity in the state sector is about 83,922 megawatts. Central sector is about 1,03,000, and private sector is 1,59,000. In other words, private sector is contributing to roughly about 45%, roughly around 46% of the installed capacity. Out of which, again, the thermal power is concerned around 2,21,000. And again, that's the same thing. In the coal based is about 1,95,000. That's about 56.6%. The gas and oil based is about 7.2%. Hydro is about 13%. Nuclear 2%. Renewable energy is 20.8 sector. However, you know, the renewable energy, though it's increasing, how reliable and how far it can be relied on is a question as we go along on a consistency basis, especially considering our renewable energy is of more of a solar based. The over years, there's a growth in generation of energy. However, if I notice the figures, from 2009-10 to 2018-19, gradually it is decreasing. Though year on year there is a few million units is being added, this is the question which why, and why is the reason, what is the reason for this decrease in generation? Or the, is it that installed capacity is not being utilized, or installation is not being done? There's a question which you need to ponder over. I'll skip the plant load factor, etc. When it comes to non-performing assets, now you all know there are about a total 34 units. As on today, 34 plants, out of which 32 are thermal power plants. And all these 32 belong to the private sector. They all have been classified as the NPS. The amount involved is about 1.74 lakh crores, a huge money. Now, the one silver lining about this status of the resolution, out of this 34, the total combined capacity is about 24,400 million megawatts. Under construction is 15,725. The reasons are non-availability of fuel, cancellation of coal blocks, Then projects set up without coal linkages, lack of PPAs from the state authorities, inability of the promoters to infuse the equity and working capital. One of the contentious issues is with respect to the disputes which the DISCOMs raise. In fact, this is very peculiar to Andhra Pradesh and either of the combined Andhra Pradesh or of the present bifurcated two states, and also the partly in Karnataka. There, naturally, once the asset becomes a non-performing asset, bankers are, they are only money lenders. Naturally, they will go after the institutions. But there is also a silver lining from the government point of view, the introduction of the various schemes. Ujjwal DISCOMS Assurance Yojana, UDAI scheme, then Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Gram Jyoti Yojana, Integrated Power Development Scheme, 24/7 Power for All joint initiatives with the state governments, augmentation of transmission capacity, Shakti, that's with respect to coal allocation. Then gas power, this is again peculiar to Andhra Pradesh, because most of the gas-based power plants are located in Andhra Pradesh. GMR Rajahmundry, Lanco Kondapalli, Reliance Power Samalkot, RVK Energy, Panduranga Energy, they are all before the NCLT now. The combined capacity of all these gas-based power plants is about 24,000 megawatts, out of which about 14,000 megawatts were allotted gas at subsidized rates by the government. So they are receiving part of the money. Then Konasima project, again 445 megawatts is with NCLT. It so happened that all of these people were my clients earlier, before I took up the office. I also know in and out of the reasons. Without being judgmental about the regulators, what I found over a period of 15, 20 years of association with them, right from their inception of drawing up a PPA to their commissioning and their selling, the most of the disputes relating to are on account of the inability of the DISCOMs to meet the financial obligations, timely financial obligations. Then they find a way of creating a dispute which ends up in initially in the courts, thereafter with the regulators. The regulators also, the on account of the judgment of the Supreme Court in Gujarat Urja case, whether it is an though there is an arbitration clause in the agreement, there is a mechanism of providing for a backup payment system of either opening a LC or by way of creating a escrow account or by way of providing bank guarantees. Neither the promoters or the power producers had the muscle to enforce or seek enforcement of those clauses, which ultimately left them to the mercy of the DISCOMs to make payment or not. While payment was being made from time to time on a ad hoc basis, there was always a huge amount of backlog which is locked up in the litigation, and the regulators being for most of the time in most of the parts of the country, regulators not being well versed with the legal nitty-gritties, or they are connected with most of the regulators being drawn up from the public sector undertakings and also from the erstwhile electricity boards. Not that they sit with the bias, but if their understanding or approach to the particular problem would be not in the commercial sense, but in the sense of the how do I protect the public interest element which they perceive to be the public interest. But in the process today, the see, if you look at the total amount of money which is locked up in this trust asset, and this, if this trust assets have to go down, the amount of public interest which they get served is for anybody's imagination. I leave the other these things. So far as the circular of the RBA, I leave it to the panel discussions for, because the, as I said, being a sitting judge, I have limitations of making a comment either one way or other. Except to state that if you look at the RBA circular, the RBA circular is not meant only for power sector. As per the available statistics, there are about 100, roughly around 80 to 100, the across the various sectors, there's a problem with respect to the non-payment of dues. Could be for various reasons, some intentional, unintentional. But the fact of the matter is, amount locked up is a huge capital. From that perspective, probably the courts would be viewing rather than from the perspective of the only the power sector. While argument of the power sector could be that we have various differentiating factors which require the court or as well as the RBA to take into consideration. Those are all matters where probably the experts from your side and from here are the ones who need to crystallize and present before the courts to enable the courts to make that differentiation and come to the rescue of the power producers. And in those context, ironically, the so-called public interest or the public interest element of public money being involved in the process, huge public money being involved in the process, can be properly put forward. Those are all for my advocate, good advocate friends who would be doing the job in the context. You know, one other parallel sector which I've been observing is that of late, if you look at the many hospitals are being taken over by companies either incorporated in Singapore or in Malaysia or in Saudi Arabia or Dubai. Corporate hospitals, promoters, mostly doctors, they start with ambitious ideas. Thereafter, a financial partner enters into. After a particular point of time, they virtually take over. In fact, it's been happening in a few of the states very silently. The question which is required to be considered, or the problem which is required to be considered, is that for the next generation, what would be the cost of servicing for a patient? It could be your son, daughter, grandson, grandchild, etc. In other words, we are slowly letting to go the system into a particular mechanism. The power sector also, I look at it from that angle, because as I see recently, at least out of these stressed assets, two of the stressed assets have already gone into third parties' hands. One I noted is that Tata Power taking over Jayaprakash Prayagraj. It's about 6,000 crores. Then I was looking at whether is it the Tata Power who had funded this. Then I found there is various other financial partners who were funding the Tata Power out of the 6,000 crores. And per megawatt, the total megawatt roughly is around 2,000. Then per megawatt cost is working out for 3 crores. In that context, again, probably you need to discuss if for 3 crores per megawatt power plants are available, why do the government need to, or why do the financial institutions to support a power plant which is going down at the rate of where the calculations are being put at the rate of 6,000 or 5,000, 6,000, etc. Even giving benefit to the cost of inflation. Likewise, other one which I found is that a 1200 megawatt power plant of SKS Power, which is being taken over by a Singapore-based company. So slowly but steadily, probably all these power companies may slip into the hands of the financiers abroad. The notwithstanding the promoters struggling, putting up first generation promoters putting up these kind of plants, in that context, the august body can deliberate, and experts can probably make suggestions, and out of box solutions can be found, as my good friend had suggested. Leaving these thoughts for you to discuss, I take leave. Thank you very much.